Welcome to The One Show with Adrian Chiles.
And Christine Bleakley, and a man whose career can be traced through his hairstyle.
From the hairy hippie in a Coronation Street look.
I like that one. I like that one better. The professional's perm. Marvellous.
Can it get better? Of course it can. To the judge, John Deed wig.
He wasn't wearing a wig because he's got no hair. He's got plenty of hair. Martin Shaw is here. Martin, lovely to have you.
Thanks for that, Bob.
Have you got a favourite there?
Well, I can tell you which one is not. Yeah. Wild guess. Yeah. Those hairstyles now just look so bizarre, don't they?
Yeah.
But I mean, having your hair,
no, I mean,
having your hair like this then was as radical as shaving it is now.
Yeah.
You know, you just felt like you were really cool and amazing and doing something extraordinarily radical.
You're a bit of a Brummy, which I like. You're an Aston Villa fan, which I don't like, but you, we can hear the accent.
You're West Bromwich Albion.
Oh, no. Well, I can just hear the accent's coming back the more we talk.
No, never. I can't be doing with you.
George Gently, let's have a look at your haircut in this one. It's a very clean-cut kind of look, isn't it, for a 60s detective?
If you think that's clean-cut, my face looks like a bag of spanners.
No, it
don't be unkind.
Doesn't, absolutely not. We'll be chatting about the new series, of course, shortly as well, Martin.
It's 30 years, almost to the day, since Margaret Thatcher came to power.
Everyone agrees the day marked the dawn of a new era, but whether what came to pass over the next 11 years was a triumph or a disaster still divides opinion.
Opinions voiced here for The One Show by two polar opposite political ever-presents of the Thatcher years.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope. The ladies not for turning.
Margaret Thatcher defined herself by the things that she was against. The Soviet Union, trade unions, nationalisation, high taxes. She was a dragon slayer.
Frankly, I never thought that Margaret Thatcher would last. I thought she was a bit of a joke. I thought the policies, which were cutting government spending, rolling back the state, breaking the trade unions, would be disastrous. I thought she'd be nothing more than a hiccup in the onward progress of social democracy.
No, no, no.
During the election that brought Margaret Thatcher to power for the first time, I was 25 years old and I met her every morning to brief her for her press conferences. Britain was then considered the sick man of Europe, crippled by strikes and thought to be ungovernable.
Margaret Thatcher's honeymoon was actually one of the shortest in British history. It lasted 6 weeks and then she was in negative polling figures. But she was also very lucky. Why? Because we staged a civil war in the Labour Party fighting each other and she had North Sea oil. It was coming on stream. She could do what she wanted.
When the military dictator of Argentina invaded the Falkland Islands, people expected Britain to roll over. And I don't think any Prime Minister other than Margaret Thatcher would have gambled on sending a fleet 8,000 miles to free the islanders.
General Galtieri invaded the Falklands and gave her the chance of what was effectively a great victory. She was able to sail on it and the full flowering of Thatcherism.
The unions needed to be confronted, but it turned out to be a nasty business. When Arthur Scargill organised a miner strike without a ballot, hoping to bring down the elected government with power cuts, Margaret Thatcher held out.
By seriously weakening the great basics of the economy, coal, steel, the railways, privatising the utilities, all of which weakened the unions who were, in her eyes, the enemy within.
It was a long and bitter dispute, and it ended in the union's defeat.
The miners were broken, the pits were closed, Thatcher'd won. She triumphed.
Margaret Thatcher helped people with aspiration. She encouraged council house tenants to buy their homes, giving them a stake in society and recruiting them to the middle class.
The houses were sold off on the right to buy on very preferential terms. The estates became dumping ground because no new council houses were built to replace the ones that were sold. Don't
you want me? She certainly made it perfectly acceptable for people to be filthy rich, and Labour was only able to, you know, get in by adopting a similar kind of idea. So, you know, one of the big things she did was she changed Labour as well.
They privatised almost the whole of public sector investment. She'd never have done that. She thought Blair was terrific. I mean, there is no wafer between Thatcher and Blair and Brown, except the names of the parties.
Because we gave up social democracy, we gave up the trade unions, we embraced privatisation, we embraced market forces, we became Thatcherite with a human and a smiling face.
You either loved or hated Margaret Thatcher, but even her class enemies and the misogynists must admit that under her, Britain played a big part in the world. The economy did well, the trade unions were tamed, ordinary people bought shares and houses. It was a fantastic legacy, and it was all down to her.
The nation took a 30-year holiday from its problems, a 30-year holiday in which it rejoiced and, in debt and borrowing and greed. And now that 30-year period is over. It's reached its own nemesis because the recession means that the state has to become important again. The state has to spend to get us out of depression. We need regulation. We need state intervention. In a recession, we're all social democrats now.